But I want to talk about homeoprophylaxis, okay? This is something that is, people keep coming to me. I will tell you that, you know, as I travel the nation talking to people that have children with autism, I've always, you know, I'm not sure. My parents tried some homeopathy when I was a kid. It always seemed like a sugar pill. I wasn't sure if it was hocus pocus. Maybe it's the placebo effect. I don't know. But so many people in this movement that have injured children have really seen huge changes from homeopathy. And, you know, homeopathy is just this tiny, inert little substance that's supposed to trigger our immune system. At least that's my understanding of it. But it came out under fire recently. I want to show you what the FDA, do we have this article on the FDA? FDA plans crackdown on homeopathic remedies. This was coming from the Associated Press. There it is. Let's fire that up real quick. FDA plans crackdown on homeopathic remedies. This is Scott Gottlieb. Now, Trump may be making some decent decisions. I think this jerk is not one of them, but you know, I'm looking forward to being proven wrong because it would be great to see that he's a good guy. But I think this is highly, highly misguided, going after homeopathy. I mean, you know, you can't have it both ways. You can't say that this is a totally inert substance, doesn't do anything for you, and then say it's dangerous at the same time. But I'm going to let somebody else say that in more eloquent terms. I want to talk to Cilla Whatcott. Is that right? I got your name. Cilla Whatcott. Okay, there we go. Cilla, are you with us?
I am, Dal. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming on. So, you know, I talked to you just a moment before, and as I say to people, you know, when I worked on the Doctor's Television Show, we would pre-interview every single person we were going to have on the show because we wanted to know exactly what they were going to say, and then we would frame the discussion so we would get exactly what we want out of them. I don't run this show this way. In fact, you started talking and said, okay, I don't want to hear where you're going, because what I want this show to be is how I learn things. As a journalist, I really do have questions, and I want to see if I was to interview you, yes, I could show you what I learned. I'd rather see the questions I was asking so that people can learn and experience this is how you have a conversation. So it's really great to bring on great minds and specialists like yourself. I have questions about homeopathy and homeoprophylaxis, but here's the one point that I do make publicly. When I say, if you ask your average person, how does a vaccine work, they would probably say, well, you know, it's a tiny little bit of virus, just a teeny weeny bit of virus in some sort of inert substance like saline solution. And when we put it in our bodies, because it's so small, our body's able to beat the virus without it sort of taking over. And so we get immunity without actually getting the disease. And I say, you know what? That sounds a lot more like the definition of homeopathy than of vaccines, because vaccines isn't some inert solution. It's got, you know, aborted fetal tissue, pig and cow DNA. It's got mercury and aluminum, neurotoxins, all designed to sort of excite our immune system and activate our immune system and possibly overactivate it, which then causes all of the neurological diseases and autoimmune diseases that I think are running rampant. Is that a fair assessment? Is homeopathy sort of a tiny little bit of an ingredient in, you know, how does it work? What is it?
Well, homeopathy itself is the matter of like treating like. So yes, we start with the original substance that is made from the disease in homeoprophylaxis, for instance. But you said it perfectly, Dale. You gave us the Reader's Digest version, because homeoprophylaxis is different from vaccines in four major areas. One, the way that it's introduced to the person. Vaccines are injected, that bypasses the natural immune system. Homeoprophylaxis is put in the mouth where it touches mucous membrane. That's where immunity starts. And two, excipients. Vaccines have adjuvants, they have preservatives, they have antibiotics. Homeoprophylaxis has none of that. It's completely pure. In fact, it's an energetic version or a frequency of the original disease. So it's like downloading information.
Hold on 1 second. Can you just turn her down a little bit? My headset's a little loud. Okay, go ahead.
The third thing is mediums, and you touched on this. We don't use foreign mediums, so we're not introducing foreign DNA into the human biome. And the fourth thing is the emphasis on Th2 with vaccines. Vaccines are designed to create inflammatory response, an immune response that creates antibodies. This is not the goal of homeoprophylaxis. It's a more balanced application. And many parents will say, can we get titers? Will we see antibodies? We always say, no, we don't promise antibodies. And there was a study done out of Cuba where they took rats with leptospirosis, injected them with leptospirosis. All of those without HP died. All of those with HP, 80% lived.
Homeoprophylaxis, meaning HP, gotcha.
Okay, and most importantly, those 80% that survived had no antibodies, none. So antibodies are not the gold standard. We know that people are high responders, low responders, non-responders. We know that antibody action wears off. We know that it unbalances the immune system. It's not really the gold standard of immunity. And even some immunologists would argue this point as well.
Yeah, well, and I think even here in California, where they have a forced vaccination law, if antibodies was everything, they would let children test out and say, look, I have high titers for measles, mumps, rubella, whatever. I don't need that vaccine. They don't accept that. They don't accept that because they don't trust their own science, and they know it's bull. They know that the antibodies aren't actually what determines whether you're safe or not. And so they're not allowing parents that. So, constantly, our medical establishment is talking out both sides of their face. For instance, you know, I remember, what was it, last year that they Hyland, I think it was the teething pills, they blamed on seizures or something like that, and they tried to, you know, get rid of them. Here's what I find interesting. First of all, if you get a vaccine and your child has seizures, they say, don't worry about it, it's normal. It's fine. Your child will be fine. It's just febrile seizures, no big deal. But if your child has teething pills and they have seizures, we have to discontinue that from the market. Talking out both sides of the face. You know, they also, and I would assume, I'm going to go ahead and assume that the people that were using the teething pills probably got a vaccine the day before, said my child has seizures, and they're like, oh my God, vaccines are in trouble. How are we going to get around this? Did they take anything else? Did they drink? Well, they had some teething pills. That's it. It's the teething pills that cause the seizures. I mean, this is how this works. But even more so, the idea that on one hand, they will say that it's totally hocus pocus. It is such a minute amount of a substance that it doesn't, like you said, the frequency. I mean, it sounds crazy talk. I'll admit it. The frequency of a virus is what's in this little sugar pill, and therefore people are trusting it. They say it works. We're saying, no, it doesn't work. And now they're not just saying, no, it doesn't work. They're lying to you. Now they're saying, no, it's dangerous. Right. So which way is it? How can the FDA play both sides of this? Is it dangerous? Does a tiny little amount of a substance actually make it dangerous? Or is it a placebo and it doesn't actually work? I mean, what do you think when you try to even defend your stance, because they're coming at you from multiple sides that don't even agree with themselves?
Correct. And we know that there's more belladonna present in some pharmaceutical products than in the teething tablets. We've used belladonna for 200 years, and in a homeopathic preparation, it's completely safe. I think that what's happening is they recognize the threat that homeopathy poses, because more and more parents want something natural, something effective, something safe, and homeopathy has a 200-year track record. We don't have deaths from homeopathy. So I even had a medical doctor say to me once, the only threat to conventional medicine is homeopathy, because it's a full system of medicine. Other than emergency medicine, which is great if you're hit by a car and your arm's hanging off.
Exactly.
You want emergency medicine, but conventional medicine doesn't treat chronic disease. It just suppresses symptoms. So they know this. So they're trying to discredit homeopathy because the interest is being regenerated in our society for something natural.
A lot of people don't know the entire British royal family lives on homeopathy, as I understand it. They're huge proponents. They're obviously loaded. They can have the best doctors in the world, the best vaccines in the world, and they choose homeopathy. What, you know, is that, I mean, how do they keep that out of the news? And so are they saying that the entire royal family is crazy and they're not healthy? I mean, those boys are strapping, gorgeous, beautiful, hunky guys strutting through the world as we see it. Homeopathy seems to be working fine for them.
Okay. Also, Dell, in India, homeoprophylaxis is sanctioned as a legal substitute for vaccines. So people can choose either vaccines or homeoprophylaxis. They literally put signs up in public places saying, come get your HP during specific epidemics. So it's respected and it's utilized.
And they're seeing results, right? I think they're getting better results in India from homeoprophylaxis.
Absolutely. I mean, the studies are out there. Many of them are observational studies. There are some double-blind placebo-controlled studies, one for the flu and using something called influenzinum. But we see fabulous effects with chikungunya, cholera, Japanese encephalitis, leptospirosis, meningitis. All of these tropical diseases respond very, very well to homeoprophylaxis.
So, you know, my argument would be this. You know, I, as I said at the top of this piece, that, you know, I kind of would prefer, I think, my children get the natural disease. And, mm-hmm. you know, I think our bodies, I feel like I live in a world where we're designed to interact with disease, and it probably enhances our immune system. Is there an advantage, you know, do you say, no, you're wrong, Dell, you should use homeoprophylaxis, it's better than getting chicken pox or measles? What is your thought on that?
You're absolutely right, Dell. Natural disease is the best. And there's a book out by Neil Miller, Critical Vaccine Studies, that shows through PubMed studies that natural disease helps to impact long-term health outcomes, fewer tumors, fewer cancers, lymphomas, etc. So natural disease is good, and it has a place. Mother Nature put it in place for a reason. Some people can't withstand natural disease, so they're at a higher risk based on their susceptibility. So basically, homeoprophylaxis is a form of natural disease. It delivers all the benefits with none of the risks, because there are not deaths from homeoprophylaxis. And there was one study done in Australia, 15-year study with about 3,000 children. One of the groups was unvaccinated, and one had the HP. And they found the HP kids had better long-term health outcomes, fewer atopic illnesses, allergies, eczema, than the unvaccinated children. So this was perplexing at first, but all we can deduce is that delivering the natural disease at a frequency level where there's no risk and all the benefit confers the same benefits as natural disease. Wow. So that's the beauty of homeoprophylaxis.
Do you know, in California, so, you know, obviously I travel around a lot. There's three states that really have no exemptions from vaccines. Is it possible to use homeoprophylaxis as a way to sort of say you've done your job, you know, taking care of your child's immunity and get them into schools? Anyone having success with that? Is that in your wheelhouse? Do you even know?
I'd say only through civil disobedience.
Okay. You know,
finding somebody on your page that's willing to sign off for that. That's not something that's going to be broadcast. You know, it's through a personal relationship with somebody who's able to sign off and check the box, because it is effective. And it's not sanctioned by our government. It's not recognized as a substitute. So until people start just standing up for what they believe, change can't happen.
Amen. Amen to that. So you have do I understand there's a movie coming out that's going to sort of get into homeoprophylaxis?
That's correct. It's coming out in the next few weeks.
Oh, great.
There'll be a free viewing for 36 hours for all people who sign up on this free list. And
is that at realimmunity.org? Is that what I'm looking at? Is that where they sign up? Let's bring that up. Let everybody see that one more time really quick. So go right now to realimmunity.org and sign up so that you can watch this film for free during the 36-hour window that they're allowing you to do that.
And it's basically my effort. I've produced and directed this because parents need to get past the fear. Fear is what's driving this bus in the wrong direction. Parents need to overcome the fear, recognize how to listen to their intuition and the intelligence of life itself, and have confidence in the fact that no one is going to look out for their children like they are, and they can make important decisions as long as they research and get their information. And that's episode one. Episode two will be resources for parents to build their own toolkit. Chiropractic, functional medicine, Chinese medicine, gemotherapy, homeopathy, and homeoprophylaxis. Because I'm not one to say that there's a right way and a wrong way. We have many choices, and people need to choose for themselves and trust their choices. So I want to really highlight homeoprophylaxis as an option, a choice. And I've interviewed researchers, doctors, families using it, a deep dive into homeoprophylaxis, but along with these other resources, and just a deeper understanding about health and how we support our natural immunity. It's our gift. It's not something that comes through a pill or a needle or someone outside of yourself granting it to you. We have natural, real immunity, and my film is an effort to share that with people, because I have patients every day in my office, Dell, who are racked with grief over what's taken place in their lives. Mm. And I've got to find the best possible way to teach. And this is my effort, my contribution to doing that.
Wonderful, Cilla. So I just realized, and I was just told again, if you type ICAN, I-C-A-N, into the comment, we do have a link to that film in the 36-hour window you can watch it in. So that's an easy way to get to it. Cilla, obviously, you know, we could talk for hours. It's fascinating. I really did learn something, and I am going to look into it more for my own children, because, you know, I'm sitting here thinking, what risk is there? I mean, honestly, you know, what's the big deal? Right. If it works, it works. If it doesn't, it doesn't. If I'm guided to do other things. But it's one of these things that, honestly, it's like drinking more water. Okay, how hard can that do, as long as you don't drown yourself in 20 gallons of it? All right. So,
now, I just want to add one more thing. Okay. This is a website, Americans for Homeopathy Choice. The FDA has open input until the 20th of March. The more people write in, the better it will be. And this website, Americans for Homeopathy Choice, gives you formats, templates, they make it very, very easy. Two moms have started this organization to protect our rights with homeopathy.
We're going to get on it. Everybody out there, Americans for Homeopathy Choice, get in there. This is how we make a difference. People keep asking me, what do I do? What can I do about this? These are the things that are working. These are why we're seeing HHS, you know, creating new divisions of civil rights and things like that. Cilla, thank you for taking the time today. I look forward to talking to you soon, and I can't wait to watch that film. I know what it takes to make a film like that. Congratulations on finishing it, getting out there. I hope it's a huge success. And everybody, these are the types of ways that you can educate yourself and get more information. And you know what? I think with all of these things, you'll know when it's right for you. Take in the information, and in your heart, you go, you know what? Something about that rings true for me. I think that's what's going to work for me. Or I have this thing going on with my child. I haven't been able to figure it out. And the second I heard that one element, bing, you get a ding. Something goes off. Something happens and says, I think I'm supposed to try that. I can't explain that. Is that God? Is that intuition? Is it mean you're psychic? I don't know, but we've got to open up to that part of ourselves. I think it's the greatest part of our healing journey, is somewhere inside of us, we know what we're supposed to be doing, but we got to get the clutter out of our heads. We got to get the fear out of our heads. We got to stop reading news headlines and start looking into the eyes of our children, looking in the mirror and saying, what is it I need? And then take information in. You may watch this documentary and say, it doesn't ring for me. Others will say, oh my God, I know that's what it's going to be. That's what I think. That's why you take this information in. Go see this film. Take the advantage of that 36 hours, and you can get that by typing in ICAN. Cilla, have a wonderful day. I look forward to talking to you soon.
Thank you, Dell. Thank you.
All right, great. Well, you know, we were talking about HHS is starting this civil rights division, religious conscience. I mean, it seems obvious. I think that, and I've been talking to lawyers about, you know, for those of us that may not, I've researched vaccines. I've looked into the safety. They're not safe. They haven't used the scientific method. I'm a man of science. I believe in science. I investigate science. I love science. But if you're skirting doing good science, then I'm going to have a problem with that.